Thank you. I know how difficult it is to entertain the audience after lunch, but I'll do my best. Before doing that, let me thank the organizers for inviting me. It's always nice to be back to Budapest, but I also appreciate the discussion, which I think is very fresh and thought-provoking. Now, in terms of my presentation, I was inspired by Professor Schulze, who reminded us about the anniversary, which takes place tomorrow. And let me share with you, it will take probably 3 minutes of my time. I would suggest it would be extra 3 minutes because it's a lyrical digression. And a personal recollection, which you will like, I hope. In the evening of November 9th, 1989, I was marching across Der Große Tiergarten in Western Berlin in a group of approximately 30 people. Most of them were in their late 20s, early 30s, so-called emergent leaders from various parts of Europe, including Hungary, by the way. We were well-equipped. We had hammers, crowbars, and evil eyes, axes. And the intention was clear. We knew that something was going on close to the Brandenburg Gates, and we wanted to be a part of this historical event. So we approached the gates, and there were some other people standing there, and nobody was moving for some time, as if everybody was waiting. And I don't think there was fear, because by that time it was clear that, well, we're closing this chapter in the European history, the East German police was completely demoralized. They didn't know what to do, how to respond. So we were not scared that something bad would happen to us. But still, all of us were waiting for some signal. And out of a sudden, one of the guys, members of our very colorful cosmopolitan team, got a cassette recorder. And probably you remember in late 1980s, those of you who are old enough to remember these days, they had this double-deck cassette recorders, very powerful machines. So he pushed the button, and the brisk air of Berlin was filled with Pink Floyd. And again, maybe the younger generation doesn't really know what Pink Floyd was about, but there was a famous movie, The Wall, and a famous theme, even the words, which probably some of you remember. I promised Lubov that I will sing, and I will, you know. We don't need no education. We don't need no thought control, right? That was, and off we went. Of course, to be fair, there was nothing really heroic in this deed because our instruments were not suitable enough to inflict a major damage upon the wall. It was a pretty robust structure, fortified concrete. You could probably take a small bite out of the bowl, but you cannot really tear it down. In 2 hours, we were able to make a small hole in the wall. And we were able to communicate with those who were trying to demolish the symbol of the Cold War from the eastern side. Interesting enough, that nobody was drunk. All of us were sober. But it was a very unique atmosphere. It was like, you know, New Year holiday for a small child. You could leave everything behind you. You could start a new life. We were basically saturated with unity, with joy, and with solidarity. Of course, the whole world was in front of us. A yellow bricked road replaced Unter den Linden on the east side of the wall. And now, this is the end of my lyrical digression, the question which I raised to myself, what went wrong? Again, you know, to be fair to all of us, I think that today, Europe is more united than it was 30 years ago. Not to mention the European Union, even if you take countries to the east of Poland, of course we feel more European than we felt 30 years ago. We can travel, we can access European media through internet. If we have money, we can teach, we can study in European universities. So in certain important ways, Europe is more united. However, having said that, I should confess that the dream didn't come true. And we don't have a similar wall like we had 30 years ago, but we have many fences. And these fences divide Europe in very many ways. I don't want to say that the only problem which we have now is the fence between Russia and the European Union or Russia and the West. Of course, if you go to Istanbul, they are probably much more concerned about the inability to make a progress in the Turkish accession to the European Union. If you go to London, they have their own reasons to be concerned about the European idea and the new fences which have been erected. Take Northern Ireland, for example. But let me limit myself to Russia only and to share with you some of my understandings about what happened and why. Now, if you take a standard Western narrative, I would probably be somewhat reductionist here, sorry for that, but a standard Western narrative about what happened is very simple. Everything was just fine till a crazy guy sitting in the Kremlin, or the crazy guy sitting in the Kremlin, decided to take a part of the Ukrainian territory and ruined this cooperation, which promised so many positive fruits. I think that this is a simplified version of reality. And even if we assume that Vladimir Putin should take all the responsibility for the Ukrainian crisis of 2014, which is a question mark in my view. But if we assume that he's the only person to be blamed for this crisis, the crisis itself suggests that by 2014, he thought that he could afford this crisis, that the stakes already were so low. So, the Ukraine crisis, in my view, is a very important symptom of problems between Russia and Europe, rather than the cause of the Russian drifting away from the European Union. On the Russian side, they often say that the real roots of the crisis are the NATO enlargement and the enlargement of the European Union, which were not coordinated with Moscow and therefore produced a chain reaction. I disagree with this view as well. I think that basically, again, the enlargement of NATO is a symptom. And the real cause of the crisis, in our case, lies in the inability, I would say, mutual inability to find an appropriate place for Russia in the new European architecture. After the end of the Cold War, and I refer to Peter Schulz, after the end of the Cold War, the decision was made to rely primarily on the geographical expansion of the Western institutions that served the West so well during the Cold War, namely the NATO alliance and the European Union. But what did it mean? If the European Union and the NATO alliance are the only games in town, it means that if you're out of these institutions, you're out of Europe. It's not a very good position for a country which still believes that it's a great country. So what we saw over the last 30 years, desperate attempts to compensate for this geographical expansion of Western institutions, which Russia couldn't hope to be a member of. The first attempt early 1990s, an attempt to deprive NATO of the security monopoly in Europe. So the idea was to put some meat on the bones of OSCE. The Paris Charter, if you look at the Paris Charter, NATO is not even mentioned there. The perception was that OSCE would gradually become the security provider in Europe. It didn't work. It didn't work partially because in the West they considered OSCE to be an irritant, unnecessary institutional adversary to the NATO alliance, and partially because Russia itself was not ready to invest enough political capital into upgrading the institution. Fine. The second option was, okay, you know, Russia cannot be a member to NATO or the European Union, but let us figure out how we can give Russia some kind of special status. So we got the NATO-Russia Council, and we got four spaces and roadmaps in the relations between Moscow and Brussels. However, the NATO-Russian Councils fell short of expectations. Russia believed that it should be a decision-making body. NATO thought that it would be just an information exchange body. So essentially, Russia was invited to a cocktail party, thank you, but not to the dinner following the party. Not good enough. With the European Union, again, four spaces, roadmaps, EU-Russia summits twice a year, but in reality, it was the same approach, the same acquis communautaire that was used in dealing with accession countries. So, as someone mentioned here, I think with the European Union, basically you are either at the table or you are on the menu. So Russia found itself on the menu. Again, not a very great position for a country which claims to be a major player in Europe. Finally, what Russia tried, to convince the European Union and NATO to build a new greater Europe on two pillars. Now, in the security field, we have our own security organizations, at least an embryonic one, the so-called CSTO, Common Security Treaty Organization, which unites most of the post-Soviet states. In the economic field, we have the Eurasian Economic Union, and the idea was that, okay, we should convince the European Union to partner with the Eurasian Economic Union, and we should convince NATO to partner with CSTO. It didn't work either, because in the West, they didn't consider these institutions to be important and serious enough to claim the position of equal partners to their Western peers. They don't consider these institutions to be really peers. So what does it mean? It means that the Russian drift to Asia was practically unavoidable. And one can say, well, you know, Asia is much more difficult for Russia than Europe. You don't have such an experience in dealing with Asian countries. You don't know them as well as you know European neighbors. You don't have Russian-speaking diasporas in Asia, at least not of the size that you have in Europe. You don't have all these managers trained in Asia, and you have these managers trained in Europe. You don't have the level of penetration of Chinese companies or Korean companies, which can be compared to the level of penetration of Italian or German companies in Russia. So why Asia? I think that Asia, if you put aside the economic dimension, the economic boom of Asia, everybody is pivoting towards Asia because it's a growing market, it's a very dynamic region, so there is nothing wrong. But why Asia versus Europe? I think that Asia today has two advantages for policymakers in the Kremlin compared to Europe. First is that there are no countries in Asia which would turn the so-called Russian threat into their identity issue. In Asia, they look at Russia as an opportunity rather than as a challenge. Nobody in Asia, South Korea, Japan, India, China, would consider that Russia is a threat and that tomorrow it will occupy them. They don't need to use their anti-Russian stance for consolidating their national identity. In Europe, I don't want to name names, but there are countries which, you know, basically, you know, they base their identity on anti-Russian sentiments. So it's a different story. And you can see that when Putin stages his economic summit in Europe, basically no one of big shots comes there. When he stages a similar event in Vladivostok, he has leaders of China and India and Japan and South Korea and many other countries. So there is a different attitude. And the second difference, which is also important, you know, in Europe, you already have a very robust, a very comprehensive set of rules, institutions, and procedures. If you want to join them, you should play by the rules which are established by someone else. Long time ago. In Asia, it is still in the making. You can say, well, you know, BRICS is not serious, it's not a real institution, though I always thought that it was a situation alliance, but still it is gradually growing, it has taken some shape, and maybe it will continue. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization, again, it has many deficiencies. It cannot be compared to the European Union, but its flexibility gives you an opportunity. The entry ticket costs less than an entry ticket to the European Union or to any serious institutional arrangement with the European Union. That's why I think that this pivot will continue. As far as Europe is concerned, I think both you have, how much time do I still have?
15.
So I think that in certain ways Russia is doomed to move away from Europe in the immediate future. If I were to single out what we can expect in this relationship within the next couple of years, I would say that, first of all, clear enough, there is no interest in Moscow in any escalation of this conflict. It makes little sense. I think that the Russian policy in Europe is likely to be risk-aversive rather than risk-taking. It is likely to be reactive rather than proactive, and it's likely to be opportunistic rather than strategic. On the other hand, I don't see any readiness in Moscow to pay for resuming a dialogue with European neighbors. There is an ideal that, you know, we made mistakes, you made mistakes, let's turn this page, let's start a new chapter. But this is clearly not what the European Union can afford, because that means business as usual. And many here would say, well, it's about appeasement. We basically reward Putin for his bad behavior. We cannot do that. Before restoring relations, Putin has to pay the price. So here we still have a big gap in perceptions, and this gap will set certain limitations on what can be done in the immediate future. I think that this situation might last for a couple of years. And one of the issues here is that the European Union is a moving target. We really don't know what will happen here. And for Putin, who is well known for his transactionalist, unilateralist approach to international relations, there is no interlocutor on this side. Macron has some great ideas, but he is weak domestically. Merkel, of course, is important, but she's already on her way out, sort of. The new composition of the commission is not very encouraging. Italy is in a permanent crisis. You know, the United Kingdom probably should not even be mentioned in this context. So there is nobody to talk. And that's what bothers me when we are thinking about what kind of concessions Russia can or should make on the issue of Ukraine. Because right now, at least in my view, there is a perfect situation, maybe the best possible situation for reaching a compromise on the Ukrainian issue. I don't think that we will have a better president in Kyiv, a president who would be ready to demonstrate flexibility. But many people say, well, you know, if we were to make concessions, we should make concessions to Europe rather than to Ukraine, because they deny independence of Ukraine. They say that Kyiv is a puppet in the hands of the West, and basically Kyiv lives only on the life support system, which is provided by the European Union, partially by the United States. Again, in my view, this is not exactly the right picture. I think that we should not underestimate the resilience of the Ukrainian society, not the Ukrainian state, but the Ukrainian society, but that's how many in Moscow look at the situation. So a lot will depend on whether the European Union is able to come up with an integrated policy towards Russia, because what we see right now is the so-called Mogherini Five Principles, and again, you know, I don't want to sound condescending, but these five principles, in my view at least, do not constitute a strategy. And when I go to Brussels, many people there tell me, well, you know, we understand that we need a real discussion on Russia, but we don't want to start this discussion because this discussion might ruin this very fragile consensus, or, you know, at least the semblance of consensus that we have. Not good, not good. I think that maybe the time has come for the European Union to have a real discussion on Russia, which will not necessarily lead to softening of the European position, but it will bring some clarity and some predictability in what we can expect from Brussels and from major states of Europe. So, since my time is running out, let me give you, you know, two conclusions. The bad news is that, in my view, there'll be no institutional solution for the relationship between Russia and Europe anytime soon, because we don't know the direction in which the world is evolving. The jury is still in session, and the perceptions of the world are very different. They are very different in Moscow from what dominates the European political mainstream. And both sides have their arguments about how the world might look like, what are the driving forces, what is the appropriate global order we are moving to. So I think that institutionally it would be difficult. I can imagine some resumption of Russia-EU negotiations at a higher level, especially if there is a progress in Ukraine, which I think is possible, at least on Donbass, but which will require certain political will and some kind of political courage on both sides. But it doesn't mean that Russia ceases to stay as a European country. I think that this whole idea of the Eurasian identity is a chimera. You know, I don't understand what people are talking about, what this identity is all about. Clear, Russia is a European country, and I would emphasize even further that in order to be viable in Asia, Russia should articulate its European identity. For me, the best experience of successful integration to the Asian context is presented by countries like Australia and New Zealand. Australia was able to bandwagon and to use to the full extent the Japanese economic rise in 1970s, 1980s. But why they were able to do that? Not only because they were able to sell mineral resources and hydrocarbons to Tokyo, but also because they were able to provide value-added services, education, banking, R&D, and many other things that Japan needed. They were different. They were different from a standard Asian country, and that's why they were so successful in integrating themselves into the Asian framework. And I think the same is true for Russia. Russia can and should work with China. It can and should work with India, but it should not, and I think it cannot, compromise its European identity. On the contrary, this identity makes Russia a unique player in the Asian framework. And that means that some relations with the European Union remain critically important, even if you take a very narrow economic perspective, which is definitely not the way you should think about Russia. But even if you take pure economic interests, it's important to maintain relations with Europe, because Europe is the source of new technologies, of best corporate practices, of social capital. There are many reasons for Europe to remain indispensable. So since we are not able to find an institutional solution to our problems, I think we should take a kind of soft approach, including regimes, including non-binding agreements, including maintaining this common European space wherever we can. Let me give you just one example. Russia is a member of the Bologna process and a very active member. We have a lot of exchange programs among universities. I think these should be encouraged. Maybe we should think about liberalizing the visa regime between Russia and the European Union for special categories of population, for scholars, for students. I think that there is a potential to develop more a partnership in areas like civil society, culture, and other soft areas. So I don't believe in a breakthrough, but I don't think that a new Berlin Wall will emerge once again in Europe. I think that we will have to deal with much smaller fences. And these fences can be dealt with if we have political will and if we have a long-term vision, because what we had back in 1989 was very romantic, very naive, but a kind of very compelling vision of united Europe, which I think should be resurrected and moved forward. Thank you.